Hey there, Eli here, and today we're going to watch the content reveal for the Forbidden Sanctum. I wasn't able to watch this live the other day, yesterday, unfortunately. Wasn't able to do it, but here we are on YouTube. And what I'm going to do here, just to make things easy for everybody, is down on the progress bar for the video, I'm going to timestamp it all so that you can kind of skip around and get my reaction and watch again for the sections that you are most interested in hearing my thoughts on. And I'll probably pause the video if I have some extra thoughts that I want to get out before we move on to the next section. If something doesn't really grab me, we'll just kind of keep moving. So, blah, blah, blah. Let's get to it.
The Forbidden Sanctum is an old Templar enclave, long rumored to be hidden beneath the Fellshrine ruins.
Okay.
Abandoned for a long time, it is now controlled by a malevolent entity. In this league, you'll explore it, find out its secrets, and deal with the evil that lurks there. The Sanctum Challenge League is a roguelike game, played out one room at a time as you explore Rayclast and the Atlas.
I love roguelikes.
In every area or map you enter, you can make a choice of which room in the Sanctum you will explore next. On the Sanctum map, you can see the contents of a few rooms ahead, enabling you to plot a path through its dangerous halls. And the Sanctum is dangerous. Like most roguelikes, you should not expect to be able to complete it on your first try. Getting to the deeper floors requires experience, knowledge, and luck. You should expect that your early attempts will fail, but over time, you'll be able to push yourself farther and farther.
Okay.
As you progress deeper into the Sanctum, you'll find a variety of treasures that will help you eventually fight your way to the dangers that await you at the end of its four floors.
Fun.
Eventually, by endgame, you may be able to push through all four floors to face the final boss. Every roguelike needs a resource to help you track how well the run is going.
Of course.
In the Forbidden Sanctum, it is your resolve.
Those little pizzas?
Here. As you explore the Sanctum, your resolve is threatened by the dangers within. When you lose all of your resolve, your Sanctum run ends.
Resolve pizzas?
Your level of resolve is maintained between consecutive rooms on your run, but is only shown when you're in the Sanctum itself.
Ooh.
The resolve mechanic applies equally to all build archetypes. Your resolve is reduced when you are hit by monsters or environmental hazards in the Sanctum, and these telegraphed attacks are not affected by regular Path of Exile defensive mechanics, such as evasion, armor, or block. While these attacks do some nominal damage to your regular life, the bulk of their impact is against your resolve.
Hmm.
This mechanic provides a mechanism for tracking your progress between rooms, where your regular life pool would long ago have been recovered. Another aspect of the resolve system is that characters who are struggling can be ejected from the Sanctum without actually having to die, avoiding experience loss or hardcore death.
Right, yep.
So maintaining a healthy level of resolve is key as you navigate the Sanctum, and that means making careful choices of what rooms you enter. Let's have a look at some of the things that Sanctum rooms can contain. Afflicted rooms cause you to gain an affliction when you enter them. Afflictions make your Sanctum run more difficult, for example, reducing your resolve recovery, causing rewards to become hidden on the Sanctum map, or causing Sanctum rooms to spawn volatile anomalies that follow you. These minor afflictions accumulate as you get deeper and deeper into a run,
of course,
making it more challenging.
Yeah.
Major afflictions exist and are a big deal. They have significant consequences, such as entirely preventing
cannot recover resolve.
So, a Sanctum run gets harder and harder as you pick up more afflictions. Sounds great. But every roguelike needs a way for you to gain power throughout your run.
Yep.
In the Forbidden Sanctum, that system is boons. Boons are beneficial buffs that help you as you progress through the Sanctum. Minor boons make things a little easier, such as slowing down monsters or adding a special shield to your resolve called Inspiration.
Okay.
Major boons don't come along often, but have large effects, such as preventing you from receiving more minor afflictions or recovering your resolve to 50% the next time you run out.
Nice.
Due to the vast variety of afflictions and boons, no two runs are the same. Generally speaking, your best Sanctum runs are the ones where the afflictions you choose have little effect on you, and the boons either counteract them or have a large benefit for the strategy you're running. Some rooms in the Sanctum contain a fountain which will restore some of your lost resolve.
Sweet.
Others contain afflicted fountains that restore even more resolve at a cost. Rooms with a treasure reward contain chests full of the Templar Aureus currency, a type of gold coin they used for commerce within their Sanctum. You'll also find some Aureus coins from monsters that you kill as you explore. These are picked up automatically,
and
like
the shop,
and are not tradable, and like your afflictions and boons, are lost when your Sanctum run ends.
Yeah.
Some rooms contain a merchant who accepts your Aureus coins in exchange for boons. Plan your purchases carefully, as you may encounter the merchant again later on with
Pauses for a sec. Increase resolve recovery. Next time you go below 20, heal for 50%. That's pretty good. Orcs coins are doubled. Nice. Merchant shop can be re-rolled. Okay.
Even more expensive boons to purchase. Occasionally, the sinister powers controlling the Sanctum will present you with the choice of making an accursed pact. You are given several pacts to choose from, and can even opt to take all that you are offered. All pacts have a big upside and a big downside.
Nice.
Which is exchanging a portion of your maximum resolve for a random major boon. It's very dangerous to make a pact, but if you pick the right circumstances, your gamble could pay off. In addition to rewards that help you progress through the Sanctum, many rooms let you immediately receive Path of Exile currency items, but with a twist. Whenever you are offered some currency items that you can receive right away, you are also offered a more valuable option that will be waiting for you after the boss fight at the end
That's
of the
cool.
current floor of the Sanctum.
That's cool, yeah.
It's a gamble.
How confident are you?
If you fail to run before you reach and defeat the boss, you will not receive the reward you picked. Later on, you're offered the extreme temptation of getting a massive currency reward that is conditional on completing your entire Sanctum run without failing.
Yeah, that's a cool idea. Okay.
At a specific point in the Forbidden Sanctum storyline, you'll discover a special altar that Templar relics can be placed on. These relics directly affect your Sanctum runs and are not lost when a run ends. They persist throughout the league as a permanent source of
massive bonuses. Okay.
Acquiring new and better relics is one of the ways you can push farther and farther with each run you try.
Sure.
Relics cannot be crafted and cannot be traded, as they represent your personal progression throughout the league.
Yeah.
You'll accumulate more than you can use simultaneously, so you'll have options to fine-tune your strategy from run to run.
Yeah.
You can store your extra relics in the Relic Locker, a free storage space like the Expedition Locker. We don't want to spoil important story details, but the end boss of the Forbidden Sanctum can drop unique items from a pool exclusive to this league. Today we'd like to show you a unique amulet called Eternal Damnation. This amulet offers a powerful way to gain additional elemental mitigation by introducing the concept of elemental damage reduction. Despite the drawback of reducing your maximum resistances, if you have sufficient chaos resistance, this is more than compensated for.
So,
because of the roguelike nature of the Forbidden Sanctum, defeating this is more than compensated.
So does Chaos Inoculation just give you straight up 50% additional elemental damage reduction? So you get 100% from CI. So
because of the roguelike nature of the Forbidden Sanctum, defeating the boss of a floor is a difficult achievement and hence rewards a lot of experience. You may fail on the way, so if you do manage it, expect a good experience boost for your achievement.
Holy shit. Nice.
Another reward you can find is a special type of relic called a Sanctified Relic that has mods that directly affect your character's build.
Cool.
You can only unlock one slot for this type of relic. And while these relics can't be crafted through conventional means, you may find special reward rooms in the Sanctum that can modify them.
These relics exist
for this league only and provide a boost to character power for players who are able to master the Sanctum. The Sanctum League offers a roguelike experience that tempts you into taking risks and rewards you if those pay off. There's a lot to explore in the Sanctum, and we can't wait to hear about your experiences.
Magma balls!
In each expansion leading up to Path of Exile 2's release, we're improving...
Okay, so hang on. That all sounds awesome, okay? That's a fantastic idea. I personally love roguelikes. I'm a huge fan of that kind of game. So to implement that into Path of Exile, with everything that they outlined, the one relic that can be like specially modified, you only get one to choose that kind of fits your build. A lot of fun. That's neat. And the little grid where you can kind of put in the little relics that modify your run and give you little bonuses and the major and minor boons and afflictions. Yeah. Yeah, that's a cool idea. Okay. Nice job, Grinding Gear, so far.
Improving Path of Exile's endgame, with new content to explore and improvements to how you customize your endgame experience. In the Forbidden Sanctum expansion, we're revamping the Atlas tree, reworking how Eldritch Altars function, and introducing two new Atlas memories.
Okay.
The Atlas tree is generally working really well, but has a few problems we'd like to address. The tree offers you the ability to specialize in killing pinnacle bosses, providing extra rewards when you do so.
Yeah.
While this sounds good on paper, it creates a situation where you're incentivized to specialize your tree for regular mapping, save up all of your boss fights, then respec fully into boss mode, and then do all of your saved up boss fights before specking back again.
True.
Ideally, the design of the Atlas tree would let you spec into one build and then just play the game. We have removed all boss bonuses from the Atlas tree, and have baked some of them into the actual base properties of the boss fights. For example, you don't need to allocate the gaze into the abyss notable that makes the Elder more likely to drop Watcher's Eye, just has that drop chance built in now.
Okay.
The Atlas tree is now focused on allowing you to specialize into content that you encounter in every map. We also want you to be able to specialize into your favorite leagues even more deeply on the Atlas tree. For each of the 10 leagues that the tree lets you disable, we've added a bunch more passives to the tree. These new passives allow you to increase the league spawn chance to much higher levels than currently possible, reduce the league even further than before.
Great. Okay.
We're making a number of changes to Eldritch Altars that mostly affect their rewards, but will also affect gameplay decisions you make involving them. Some of the key changes include splitting up the basic currency, scarab, and divination card rewards to be explicit in their description of what rewards you'll get. For example, instead of map bosses dropping 3 unknown basic currency items, the altar specifically says which currency item they'll drop.
Yeah.
As part of this change, we've removed some of the lower value yet quite common currency rewards from the pool, such as Orbs of Augmentation and Orbs of Transmutation.
Right.
Speaking
of
scarabs,
who gives a shit?
These will be less available from altars, but we've improved their availability elsewhere to offset this. Rusted scarabs can now drop from the core drop pool, and we've added a vendor recipe that allows you to upgrade your scarabs to gilded, using the normal 3-to-1 ratio. You can also perform this action from your fragment tab using the new upgrade button.
Nice.
We've made reward types exclusive to different influences, so that you know which influence type to invest in if you want to target farm a certain reward. To give you a specific example, if you run maps influenced by, say, Eater of Worlds, you'll see divine orbs from the basic currency reward more than twice as often as before. We've also rebalanced rewards so that choices that affect boss drops or influence monster drops are comparatively more valuable.
Okay.
The Wrath of the Cosmos Keystone has been reworked. Previously, it was so rewarding that players felt obligated to use it despite its extreme level of difficulty.
Yeah.
It has retained the risk versus reward element, but with the overall intensity toned down. You can now also get Awakened Gems from defeating Maven Witness map bosses. This additional reward helps further balance the expected returns from the various types of influence.
That's pretty good.
For more detail on these changes, check out the balance manifesto we posted last week.
I think they said the Enlightened patch notes. Enlightened can also draw and empower.
We introduced Atlas Memories.
And enhance.
When applied to your Atlas, they unlock a sequence of maps that tells the story of an NPC's past. These stories manifest as specialized encounters that involve a new challenge and exciting rewards. In this expansion, we've introduced 2 new Atlas Memories, describing events related to beastry and domination. The beastry memory line allows you to capture harvest monsters as beasts for your menagerie. These harvest beasts can be used in 9 new beast crafting recipes. These recipes cover an array of options. For example, you can remove one of the special modifiers from a Watcher's Eye Jewel and then add another. This can have potent results, but won't affect the life, mana, or energy shield modifiers.
Right.
You can re-roll an Awakened Gem from one type to another.
Ooh! That's cool.
Another example is that you can also re-roll a Synthesis Implicit modifier.
No.
If your item has more than one Synthesis Implicit, it will randomly reroll one of them.
Okay.
The Domination Atlas memory thrusts you into a tale of Pantheon gods that stand watch over their shrines. Like regular shrines, these are guarded by monsters and emit a buff that empowers the monsters until you claim that buff for yourself. This Atlas memory introduces a new set of shrines with specialized buffs, guarded by rare monsters that drop tantalizing rewards.
Okay.
The Forbidden Sanctum expansion introduces a new type of shard that can drop from harbingers, fracturing shards. When combined together into a full currency item, you get the fracturing orb, which behaves the same as a fracturing craft from harvest. It can be used on any rare item with at least 4 modifiers. When the orb is applied, it locks one of the modifiers in place so that further crafting efforts do not affect that modifier. Items fractured in this way can only have 1 fractured modifier. Previously, this crafting option was gated behind the Oshabi fight in harvest.
Wow.
Now that it has been rehomed to Harbinger, the Harvest crafting option is no longer available. This means that you'll be able to use your Harvest Life Force and Oshabi kills on other crafts. Because fracturing shards drop from Harbingers, you'll be able to target farm them by specking into Harbinger content.
Damn, that's good. Damn. Wow.
The Forbidden Sanctum expansion introduces a number of new skill gems. In addition to some new melee Val skills we'll discuss later in the livestream, there are 2 totally new skills that we'd like to unveil today. Volcanic Fissure is a new fiery slam skill that can be used with staves, maces, axes, and unarmed attacks.
Okay.
Strike the ground to create a chasm that winds towards your target.
Mm-hmm.
This chasm can path around corners before erupting as the fissure gets as
path
close
around
as
corners. Nice.
It releases a burst of fiery projectiles that explode on striking the ground.
Well,
Anyone
show us the pathing.
Multiple impacts will take a lot of stacked damage. Use it up close for reliable bursts of damage, or aim far away to damage a larger area. Frozen Legion is an unusual spell, summoning a ring of icy statues that attack with your own weapon damage. The skill has multiple cooldown stacks and consumes all cooldown uses at once to summon a statue for each available cooldown.
I see.
The statues perform a sweeping ice slash, and these sweeps can overlap, resulting in multiple hits against targets close to you. The spell can be used with staves, maces, and axes. The skill is particularly powerful with slow, heavy weapons, as while the statues will use your attack speed, you should instead prioritize the spell's own cast time and cooldown.
Hmm.
This expansion also introduces many new Vile melee skills. As you know, equipping a Vile skill gem grants you both the Vile and regular version of the skill. As you kill enemies, the gem charges up with their souls, and after a certain number are collected, the Vile skill can be used once.
Right.
Most of the new Vile skills introduced in this expansion are melee skills, and this results in an indirect buff to any melee builds that use one of these skills. Where previously you'd just be using your melee skill to kill enemies, you now get to periodically use a super-powered version of a skill.
Ooh.
If you like Flicker Strike, you'll love Vile Flicker Strike,
because
it really dials up the concept of letting fate take the wheel. Vile Flicker Strike causes you to flicker dozens of extra times, slashing enemies. During this time, you don't deal any damage to the enemies you slash. You're quite vulnerable due to not leeching or generating fortify stacks. When you finish flickering, if you survived, of course, you'll be rewarded with a single huge hit of damage against each enemy you slash.
What?
Vile Cleave is a new Vile skill that buffs the behavior as a non-Vile version, in a similar way to how Vile Reave works.
Oh, that's sick.
Vile Cleave triggers two buffs, one when you kill a rare enemy, and one when you kill either a rare or unique enemy. The latter is a strong buff to regular Cleave, which you can keep up almost permanently if you're able to kill rare or unique enemies often enough. The bonus for killing a rare enemy is that you get to steal its mods for a time. You can enjoy part of the power of having a headhunter without actually needing to find one.
That's sick.
Overall, Vile Cleave is a pretty powerful upgrade to any melee build.
Yeah.
Cleave. That +2 radius buff is looking pretty good now, right?
Yeah.
We'll showcase the other new Vile skills we're introducing over the coming week.
What? Show us now.
The Sanctum expansion introduces over 15 new unique items from Sanctum exclusive.
Let me just say real quick. That's awesome. Okay, let's keep going.
...massive uniques to ones that can be found from Path of Exile's pinnacle bosses. I'd like to show you three examples of these designed by winners of our prior league's boss kill races.
Hmm.
Progenesis is a unique amethyst flask that was designed by Ben and drops from the Uber Maven. It's a defensive flask that grants a mini version of the Petrified Blood effect, but without requiring you to be on low life. This is a useful tool to prevent you getting one-shot by large amounts of incoming damage in scary situations.
Hmm.
Rational Doctrine is a unique jewel that was designed by Rawlings and drops from Uber Venarius. By manipulating your attributes, you can change how this jewel behaves. While the ideal dream outcome is that you manage to get your strength and intelligence tied for highest, enabling both of the benefits simultaneously, the jewel is still very powerful if it only grants your choice of permanent consecrated ground or permanent profane ground. Entropic Devastation is a pair of unique gloves that were designed by Gucci Pradas and dropped from the Uber Shaper. Currently, the ways to get Spell Impale are very limited. These gloves provide the powerful property of causing all of your spells to impale on crit. So let's talk about unique weapons.
Call of Steel. Can someone tell me Call of Steel? What is that again? Calls impale debuffs from enemies alive or dead in a large area. Deals reflected damage. Oh, okay, right. And profane ground. I don't remember this. Profane ground. Ground effect that reduces resistances by 10% and increases chance to be critically hit. Okay, for enemies then.
While the ideal dream outcome is a very limited.
Okay. Cool.
So let's talk about unique weapons. Endgame unique weapons.
Yeah.
In many ways, the weapon is the most iconic and important item on a character, so it's very important that we make them exciting and worthy of their unique status.
Mm.
While some unique weapons have special properties that enable entirely new builds, others are best compared to powerful rare items as a primary source of your character's damage. Mm. We have to be very careful when pitching the power level of these unique weapons. If they're not powerful enough, then they're useless and are ignored. But if they're too powerful, then they discourage entire archetypes of characters from trying to find or craft rare weapons. Interestingly, the above problem doesn't apply to belts. Despite Mage Blood and Headhunter both existing as extremely powerful unique items, people still craft plenty of rare belts. That's because Mage Blood and Headhunter are extremely rare, and people don't actually expect they'll reliably get one in the League. Players tend to treat them as luxury upgrades to their build, rather than something they're certain to get. In this expansion, we're promoting 10 iconic but underused unique weapons to the same tier of rarity as Mage Blood and Headhunter. We are buffing them a gigantic amount, and are making them incredibly hard to find.
Okay.
Remember when Starforge used to be an exciting item? Well, after this change, it certainly is again. It still drops exclusively from the Shaper and the Uber Shaper, but it'll take a lot of runs or a lot of luck to earn it.
Damn.
Over the next week, we'll reveal the other unique weapons that have been massively buffed. We have targeted around 10 iconic underused unique weapons, and have generally buffed only their damage stats, but by a lot. We've made a number of changes to jewels that are covered in a recent balance manifesto, but in case you missed it, we want to quickly summarize what the changes are. In the Forbidden Sanctum expansion, we have made jewels a better source of ailment mitigation by buffing the values of ailment-focused jewel modifiers,
right,
and adding new modifiers that enable mitigation to a wider variety of ailments than before. We have also removed some ailment mitigation modifiers that were only available on jewels through corruption, because there are now better options through the regular jewel mod pool. This also means that other desirable corruption modifiers, like immunity to corrupting blood, are more likely to roll.
More likely, yeah,
we
right.
We want the moment of finding a unique jewel to be way more exciting than it currently is. We've added a handful of new, very powerful unique jewels, and have removed some old, less interesting ones. An example of one of these new unique jewels is Fire.
That's cool.
Which propagates any modifiers to your ignite mitigation to other elemental ailments.
That might be a little too strong.
If you're able to substantially reduce the duration of ignites on you, then you can use Fire Song to basically shrug off any elemental ailment. For full information about the other changes to unique jewels, check out the Balance Manifesto post we made recently.
It's possible that this particular jewel is going to run up against their general philosophy of if everyone is using this jewel, it's too good, right? This is a little too strong, maybe, Grinding Gear.
We've rebalanced curses to make them stronger where they matter most, against unique monsters and pinnacle bosses. We have buffed several Hex-related unique items and reworked unique items that previously interacted with Doom. To replace the Doomsday Keystone passive,
we take a look at that for a second real quick. Shotgrounds, so only the bottom mod has changed. 100% chance to curse enemies which hit you with a random hex, ignoring curse limit. Okay. That's pretty cool.
Items that previously interacted with Doom. To replace the Doomsday Keystone passive, we've brought back a version of an iconic curse-related keystone from the past. We've introduced some powerful new unique items that interact with hexes, which we'll reveal in the lead-up to launch.
For more details limit for power charges. Curses,
check out the Balance Manifesto we posted recently, or the patch notes that will come out after the livestream concludes. When we first created the Arch-Nemesis monster mod system, our goal was to improve Path of Exile's outdated set of monster mods with new and interesting mechanics that have modern game balance.
Right.
We feel that Arch Nemesis did introduce a lot of interesting mechanics, but it unfortunately had several of its own problems. We have replaced Arch Nemesis with a system that is more similar to the way monster mods worked in the past. The new monster mods are a lot simpler. They now each do one thing and very clearly state what they do.
Nice.
Each encounter with a rare monster is now less complex and is easier to understand in the heat of combat compared to Arch Nemesis. You'll still encounter challenging combinations of mods from time to time, but this emergent synergy will be rare.
Lightning Mirage when hit.
Nemesis. The goal is that combat is interesting and varied, with moments that get your heart racing, but without the frustrations of the Arch Nemesis
cooldown
system. Let's talk about rewards. Under Arch Nemesis, it often felt mandatory to bring in a magic find culling character to kill some monsters for you in order to maximize your rewards. In the new system, we've added a significant pool of new rewards to rares, but the reward that is on the monster is hidden and not associated with a specific mod, so you don't know what kind of rewards you will get until you kill the monster. Rare monsters with more mods are more likely to have these special hidden reward bonuses. To find out more about other balance changes that are taking place in the Forbidden Sanctum, check out the patch notes, which will be available when the livestream ends. Over the last year or so, some of our senior developers have been
ruthless.
A challenging way to play.
I didn't get in.
We've been publicly alpha testing this mode, known as Ruthless, for the last month, and are planning to make it available to anyone who's interested alongside the launch of the Forbidden Sanctum next week. Ruthless is an optional additional character flag, like Hardcore or Solo Cellfound, that completely changes how Path of Exile feels to play. Ruthless is a lot more difficult than regular Path of Exile. but it doesn't achieve this by making the monsters harder to kill. It instead focuses on reducing character power through extreme item scarcity, limited crafting, and many other changes such as support gems being drop-only. We've posted an article about the philosophy and rules of Ruthless on pathofexile.com/ruthless. We plan to release this mode alongside the Forbidden Sanctum expansion in a week. In addition to being a character flag like Hardcore or Solo Self-Found, it's also available as a modifier for private leagues. To be clear, the Forbidden Sanctum League content can be played in Ruthless with appropriately balanced rewards. Ruthless is still very experimental during 320, and we won't be afraid to make mid-league balance changes to it during this experiment.
I am interested in Ruthless playing Ruthless.
But so far, it has found a supportive and growing group of.
The question is, are all of you interested in watching me play that?
Like something you're interested in,
or watching my journey on YouTube? Let me know in the comments if you're interested in that.
A number of small quality of life improvements. Some examples are divine vessels can now be used by right-clicking them rather than taking them to sin.
Oh, good.
On the player overhead life bar, the energy shield bar is split into a separate bar.
Also good. You can
now right-click an itemized temple of Atzuatl to see its layout.
Okay.
And most importantly, beast crafting recipes that add mods to flasks now actually say what the mods
tell you what they do. Yeah.
We'll post more information about these and other quality of life improvements in the lead up to release. Today we're launching two new series of supporter packs, the Forge and Gemling packs. Each tier contains.
So I'm going to mute the supporters pack section and just kind of talk about what I think here. First off, I'm a big fan of Slay the Spire. That's probably one of the best deck collecting roguelike games out there, maybe the best. Huge fan of that. The whole idea, you know, of going to different floors and different rooms, having your shop, having your bonfire so you can rest and upgrade your cards and things like that. You know, this whole aspect of choice and being forced, it looks like, you know, with your resolve as your secondary health bar that is more impacted than your real health bar, your real life bar for your character, you know, having the secondary resolve bar forces you, you know, if you're having a shitty beginning of your run and you've taken a lot of resolve damage, you might have to go to a floor where you heal up some of that resolve. Whereas otherwise you can just kind of go for whatever higher damaging thing that you might want to get, or like a boon or whatever they want to call it. Having this aspect to force you to choose how you want to play the run is really cool. And the fact that it's, he said it's four floors and it looked like it was 8 or 10 individual rooms inside each floor. So what, that's like 32 to 40 rooms that you have to go through. Means this is a long duration question that Path of Exile is posing to you, is how do you manage this, right? Presumably it's going to be, or maybe they said it, but I assume, like everything else, it's going to be one portal for every instance, for every map, for every instance of a campaign map area that you might go to. So you get 32 to 40 maps to kind of potentially finish a sanctum. And if it's anything like most roguelikes, you're not going to finish sanctums right off the bat unless you are maybe exceptionally good at understanding the mentality of how to play a roguelike as well as playing Path of Exile and also having a really good build right off the bat. I suspect you could maybe finish sanctums pretty early on or sooner than most if you have both of these capabilities, not all these capabilities, if you have, you know, this knowledge of how to play these certain kinds of games. So all in all, I'm pretty impressed, you know, with the complete kind of dud, in my opinion, the last league was. This one's pretty damn good. This one's shaping up to be pretty nice. And like I said, I love roguelikes. So this is, you know, this is like saying, hey, we're going to go play, you know, Magic the Gathering in Path of Exile. I'd be like, fucking okay. Let's do it. So, yeah. So it's kind of, you know, definitely has me, definitely gripping me pretty tight. The next thing I want to say is, and kind of reiterate, I do want to play Ruthless. I have a group of friends that want to play Ruthless with me. I think I'll probably document that with local recordings and then submit them to YouTube. That's probably going to be the way I go about it. If you guys are interested in watching me play that live, I can definitely set up some Twitch streams and do that live, but I might stream just the normal game and use that to explore the new sanctum and all the things that we get to do in the the new melee veil skills, which would look sick. I mean, it's about time, right? It's about time that some of these older unique weapons like Lionized Glare and Soul Taker, you know, these really cool Starforge, really cool items that just like, they just aren't good enough anymore. So I'm a big fan of that. That's pretty cool. Some new unique items. This seems pretty wild. Some petrified blood in a flask. Okay. Yep. That's fine. Oh, the jewel changes, getting, what is this, Fire Song? Again, Grinding Gear, maybe a little too good. Maybe a little too good. We'll have to wait and see, but with being able to get reduced Ignite Duration on you, so you get, what, 3 of these jewels, and then a Fire Song? Like, 3 jewels that you would have anyway. You'd have 3 mods, which are, I mean, this jewel is probably going to be worth a lot, right? Multiplier jewels, multiplier mods plus reduced ignite duration is going to be a staple. I'm going to call it right now. Plus Fire Song. This is going to be huge. Because when you can ignore elemental ailments, you become so much more powerful, generally, across all builds. So we'll see. We'll see. I think this is going to be a bit of a problem, a bit overpowered. I think this jewel will be worth a lot. Or maybe this jewel, depending on how common it is, this particular jewel might not be worth anything, but these jewels are going to be worth a lot. Oh, man. New skills, this like Molten Strike tracking thing looks pretty sweet. What's the other one? Oh, yeah, the Mirage melee attack. I can imagine this thing gets min-maxed pretty hardcore when you get to the point where you have just a ton of images all the time instantly. And can we talk a little bit about Veil Vol? Vol, was it Flicker Strike? Where are we here? Was it earlier on? Yeah, here it is. Oh man, doing all these attacks, but you have to survive and then the damage comes in afterwards. Kind of like very anime Omni Slash type feel to it. That's pretty cool. Yeah. Okay, well, I'm sold. We're going to stop the video there. I feel like I'm just going to start repeating myself and be like, oh my god, so good. But legit, it looks like they've done some nice quality of life stuff. They've kind of looked at the Atlas tree and said, okay, we can make this better. That's great because it did a pretty good job of what it was supposed to do already. So to make it more efficient and kind of apply some of these buffs directly to the boss fight without having to spec into them, so you can focus more on speccing into the things that you want to do, like breaches or whatever map content, league content you want to do, that's super cool. It's more, it's Grinding Gear continuing to move in the direction of giving players autonomy and control over what they want to do within the game instead of the game forcing you to do certain things, like Delve, saying, hey, you have to go map if you want to Delve. That's still a bit contentious, I'd say, but you know, it's still moving in the right direction of saying, here's some more choice of how you want to play, and that's really cool. You know, my hat's off to Grinding Gear for that. You know, you have to applaud them when they do something correct, and I think in this league, it looks like they've done a lot of things correctly. Also, the Fracturing Orb, that's just awesome. That's fantastic. Being able to manually fracture things a little bit more commonly, a little more easily for, you know, the average player. I think that's good. I think opening up more crafting potential and making crafting easier is almost always a good decision. So I think that's what this does. It gives more people the ability to lock into place a certain mod that they really want, and then they can roll things and use the meta mods, like prefixes can't change, things like that. They make them a little more within reach of the average player to actually make efficient use of, because they are very expensive for, again, average players. Players that are not me, players that are not streamers in general, have trouble acquiring, maybe not necessarily acquiring some of the currency that's needed, but feeling like they can make good use of that currency through the crafting system. That's where things get tricky for the average player. So this, I think, removes a little bit of that barrier, and I feel really good about that. So that's great. new skills, new melee skills, new veil skills, buffing melee in general. That's always a good idea. The hex rework, we're going to have to look at that a little bit more in depth as things play out and look at Bane and skills that care about the hex rework. Replacing the Arch Nemesis mods, that was a good thing. That's a good thing. Arch Nemesis was just a cool idea and concept, didn't quite work out. Ruthless, you know, we've talked about that. Quality of life, that's great. New supporter packs, yeah, you know, when I get extra money to throw at that, sure, I'll do that. Would love to, but I think we can go ahead and end the video here. Thanks for watching. If you stuck around to the end or bounced around, whatever you did, all appreciated. Like and subscribe if you have not. That is super helpful to me and this channel. And we'll see you in the next league. And for now, this is Eli signing off.